Kurukarji, you can start.
Yes. Very good evening and welcome you all for this special lecture on emotional intelligence. This lecture is organized by in collaboration with our institute and alumni association. It's a joint program. So I welcome you all. We have with us subject expert Anil Salvi sir. He is a managing director and group head human resources at JM Financier, vice president of the alumni association Prabhakar Patil sir, Rajesh Bagwe sir, Dr. Eddie Patil sir. Next, we have also with us Vivek Bhatudekar sir. He is working with I think Kansai Neurolab as a GM HR, and all our team members, all the students, friends, and all the participants. It's a warm welcome for this special session on emotional intelligence. So today, the special session on emotional intelligence will be delivered by Mr. Anil Salvi. So in brief, I would like to introduce Anil Salvi sir. I'm proud to say that Mr. Anil Salvi sir is the illustrious alumnus of our institute, batch of 1988-90, and he has an experience of over 30 years, of which he has spent around 21 years within banking and financial services. And currently he is working as a managing director and a group head human resources at JM Financial Group. JM Financial is a prominent name in investment, banking, equities, wealth management, asset reconstruction, asset management, and NBFC businesses in India. In addition, he's also the CEO of a real estate consultancy business of the JM Financial. Prior to joining JM Financial, Anil ji was leading human resources functions at Royal Bank of Scotland in India, and he was working in the capacity of senior vice president and head HR. He was part of the HR integration team after the global buyout of ABN AMRO Bank by Royal Bank of Scotland, and he was a key resource in change management and integration of the Indian banking operations. Prior to that, Anil ji was a vice president of human resources at Deutsche Bank from November 1999 to 2006, almost 7 years. And during that tenure, Deutsche Bank in India underwent a major change as several new businesses and offshore facility was incorporated and existing business rebuilt. Prior to that, Deutsche Bank, he was working with capacity of head HR for Indian operations of Sintelink, where he contributed on resourcing strategy, talent management, designed and developed the HR policies, and also introduced and managed employee benefit program. And earlier that, he was head HR at the Blue Star Limited for their electronics and industrial equipment division. Anil ji started his career as a management trainee with Bartley Boy and Company through the campus selection in the year 1990. So Anil ji was selected through our campus placement in the year 1999 as a management trainee. So management trainee to current managing director and group head with JM Financial is an excellent journey of 30 years. Really, it's appreciable and motivation to our current students. So congratulations Anil ji for your achievements and looking forward many success to you. So thank you very much, and once again welcome you for this special online session on emotional intelligence. So we all are urged to hear you, and this will definitely help to molding the career of our student, current students, and this will benefit to all the audience part, I am sure. So once again I welcome all the dignitaries, all the audience, and all my student friends. So now moving forwards, I request Abhijit, please proceed further.
Thank you Kadukar sir for your warm welcome to all of us. Now I would like to call Anil Salvi sir to speak on the topic emotional intelligence for today's session.
Abhijit, we have a Vivek who is a moderator. Let him take over the moderation job.
Yes sir, Vivek sir. So we have Vivek Bhatwadekar sir over here present with us today, who will moderate today's session. So we will be having him in the next second. So over to you, Vivek sir.
Thank you so much, Abhijit. Honorable office bearers of the association, respected seniors, and the teachers from the institute, my dear colleagues and aspiring HR leaders, I'm Vivek Bhatwadekar, alma mater of 1988-90 batch. I am privileged to be given the opportunity to set the tone of today's session. Friends, experts are beginning to agree that types of intelligence other than IQ have evolved in humans over the last 2 million years. A high IQ is not enough to guarantee success in life. When you have a high EQ, you are adept to interpreting the emotional roots of your own thinking and behaviors and choosing your actions to influence the outcomes. You are also capable of making good insight into the behaviors and reactions of others. Now, what is emotional intelligence? It is said that we think and act on emotions stimulated by present environment and past events. It is in accordance with our life script. Since much of the brain function is still being researched, emotional intelligence is one form of intelligence that we are discovering or beginning to understand. In simple form, emotional intelligence is an intelligence distinct from intellectual intelligence. Both forms are deriving from different parts of brain, and so they function in different ways. It is said your EQ is complementary to your IQ because it concerns the perception and processing of emotions. There are views of intelligence which distinguish gifted individuals in mathematics, music, artistic ability, management, and technology. Emotional intelligence describes the abilities distinct from these more academic or intellectual intelligences. We can correlate this with many examples. Shakuntala Devi, who is a famous personality, we all know her, but was not much successful to manage her personal life, personal side of life. Whereas we also know Amitabh Bachchan, who has been able to come out of many failures of life and is still on. The emotional intelligence cycle is an interaction between the environment and behaviors. The way in which you respond to the environment is through the reaction around your own level of self-awareness. And the way in which you are controlling your emotions. This leads and drives your behavior. Your behaviors will then influence your environment. Your behaviors are shown in the action you take, the empathy that you show towards other people and the social skills you express in terms of working with them. Fundamental and core to all this is motivation. And motivation is there to allow you to interact appropriately with your environment, choose your behaviors in the most appropriate way, and help to work towards your own level of motivation and motivate others. Friends, in today's business scenario, it has become important for us to understand that emotional intelligence deserves much more appreciation and recognition in our day-to-day life. The Western countries have realized the importance of it and accepted much, much earlier. We also have started recently working on it, and the things are basically getting accepted in our country since last few years. Our today's session will focus more on the subject of practical application of emotional intelligence. Kadoskar sir already has given introduction of our today's speaker. I will not call him guest speaker. He is our speaker today because he is very well part of our institute. But yes, there are few things which I think Kadoskar sir has not mentioned. And this being Anil Savi is my batchmate, I know something more than what the others are knowing. I would like to also mention that Anil has a prolific management writer. His articles on HR are published in newspapers and magazines. Recently, his article on retaining the corporate culture amidst the remote working is worth reading. I think most of you must have read it. If not, you can collect the copy of it and please read it. Some of us are fortunate to be the batchmates of Anil and have close relations with him. He is a perfect gentleman, having felt well grounded. I'm sure the session would be a learning experience for all of us, and it is necessary trait for us in today's dynamic and competitive world. Over to you, Anil.
Thank you so very much. Am I audible, people?
Yes, yes.
Thank
yes,
you so
yes.
very much. And thank you, the seniors. Thank you, the association. And a special thanks to Vivek. Guys, Vivek certainly knows more than me as far as emotional intelligence is concerned. And I think, you know, hearing him talk about emotional intelligence so passionately, gave me inferiority complex. And this is not the first time he's giving me inferiority complex. He has been giving me since the time that we were batchmates. He has been among the intelligent ones, and he continues to be so, right? So, when it came to, you know, introducing me and the subject, you know, he, to be honest, you know, took the pain to understand the subject in its details. And I can share a secret. He also called me earlier on an entire to understand in terms of how he would like introduce the subject, etc. So I think there is this bit of work, I would say hard work, that has gone behind the speech, which preluded my talk. So I think, you know, it was all covered, and I feel that I think I should not present the subject of emotional intelligence anymore after hearing him. So that was, I think you must have made some notes about what he spoke about emotional intelligence, and I couldn't agree more. As far as his introduction about me is concerned, I think you need to discount it. Because, you know, that was an extremely biased introduction. He is my batchmate, right? And in our campuses, in our campus, I think, you know, generally we are extremely biased towards the people who belong to the campus, and also especially the one who belong to the batch. The 88-90 batch is in that respect a bit notorious. And there is Prabhakar Patil, who is again another friend, and a batchmate, and again a biased one, and that's the reason he's called me here, right? So I think we are all people who love each other, and we are all people who love the institute, and hence all the people who are associated with the institute, we are extremely biased towards. I have a story to tell about this particular subject, and I am no subject matter expert, right? As earlier was talked. And I am just a normal business guy. You know, you would have seen my introduction. In fact, my colleague. Oh, sorry, I'm sorry. You know, I have also today one of my colleague who works with me in JM, Asta Sabu, and she is essentially helping me with the presentation. She's the person actually, you know, who's put in the story together, even the presentation, and you see that brain, etc. I think that's her brain, and not mine. As in. Her idea, not mine. Of course, you know, she had mentioned about, you know, me being the head of HR for the firm. But I said, you know, I think I reminded her just now and told her, why don't you add also my business title? The idea being to show to the people that I guess, you know, HR being HR, I think you would you can also start looking beyond the role of HR. You start, you know, a lot of people. Have you know gone beyond their HR roles? And typically, as people progress, I think you know HR has its own kind of a career graph. You know, you become head of HR today in short span of time, maybe 15-20 years. So I became head of HR for about what 15-20 years ago, and you would have seen my introduction. So what next, right? You know, you can't do the same thing over a period of time. So now about 3 years, I head a business. I started a business called Real Estate Consulting, and the business which I head has about 250 odd people, and the current revenue of my business is about, you know, about 25 crores. That's the kind of a number that I deliver to the firm. I think, you know, why I'm basically, you know, sharing this with you is so that, you know, your horizon or your idea of getting into a job should not remain limited to human resources function. And there is a lot of people who have actually worked with me, who are part of my team. There's a guy called Amit, and he is Max Insurance COO today. So he was head of HR for retail bank when I used to be head of HR for RBS in India. And he went and joined the insurance company as their head of HR, and now he is the CEO. So he heads the operation, he heads the support functions. There are other friends of mine who also have gone into function and they head the businesses. So your function, your aspiration should not be limited to the HR as a function. It should go beyond. And coming back to the emotional intelligence as a subject, in fact, about last month, it so happened that, and you would have heard about the Narasimhanji Institute of Management Studies, right? NMIMS. So I am also on the board of SIS Institute of Management Studies, the one which is in Nehru. So I'm on their board. And of course, I go and teach there. I had got an invitation from NMIMS to do an introductory session. They have a 2 days HR flagship conference which they every year host. And apparently the guy who was going to speak about emotional intelligence, I think, you know, excused himself at the last minute. And somebody from SIS gave my reference, and the dean from NMIMS called me and said, you know, it's a short notice, about 4 or 5 days. But would you do a favor to us by, you know, doing the inaugural address? And the address subject was emotional intelligence. And then with my friend here, Asna, and there are other colleague who is not here today, Shruti, both of them are part of my HR team. We put together this particular presentation. I think we made some alterations today to the presentation, and I presented this to NMIMS, and this was about 3 to 4 weeks ago. And that's when, you know, Prabhakar Patil, who is my friend, you know, he was aware that I did this, and he said, you know, since anyways you're going to go and talking to other institute, why not, you know, you come and talk to our institute, you have to do this And he's the last person I could say no to. And here I am today with all of you. So the idea is basically interacting and qualifying yourself. So disclaimer, as they say, I'm not an expert. I'm just a student of a certain subject. And I can share my experience with you through the presentation today. So here we are, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to talk about emotional intelligence. And Asta, thank you so very much for helping me out in today's presentation. Right? So there we go. I think we can leave the brain behind. Literally, right? So, yeah. So I think, a lot of people talk about intelligent quotient versus emotional quotient, right? I think early on, I was introduced to emotional quotient, right? Superiority over the intelligent IQ versus EQ, and I don't know, you must have heard about it quite frequently too. So obviously, is it two-way interaction? People can speak or people can't speak? Can I give a shout out to people asking them to interact, or all of them are muted by the organizer? How is it going to work?
Sir, we have the attendees in attendees mode, so we can interact them with a Q&A session which we have at the last of the session.
Yeah, so you are not going to be making it two-way at this point in time, which is fine. So obviously, I think, if we can see the image here, intelligent quotient versus emotional quotient. And obviously, the intelligent quotient's intelligence is essentially going to be telling you what you see. So on top is basically your intelligence, and emotional quotient is generally underneath. You really cannot fathom the emotional quotient unless and until you work towards it, right? So I think, this is the classic example of an iceberg, right? What you see is not what is the entire truth. You're seeing a person being intelligent, but when you hire a person, when you employ the person or you engage the person, I think you're not employing him for his intelligence. Only you, as we say, we employ a person or we engage a person in his totality. So you have a totality like this, right? And that's where certain decisions go right. That's where certain decisions go wrong. So this is something which I like, in terms of representing the iceberg. And it's correlation between the IQ and EQ. And I believe in, I think, in an organization, the successful people are the people who have a high degree of emotional quotient, right? I think, there are a lot of people who would rank higher on emotional bit. Intelligent a bit, but that's alone not important for you to ensure the success, right? Again, taking this example of the iceberg, it is important to assess that there is an iceberg, and then that intelligence essentially tells you. The intelligence will also tell you that there is, there could be possible, like, I need to avoid the iceberg, right? But there is something which is always, the quality which is underneath, that's something which we need to recognize. Just to share with you, when I passed out of MILS, clearly I was not among the top 10 or 20% of the students who passed. And probably today, after 30 years, I could certainly be among the top 10 or 20 percent of the alum who would have seen a fair bit of success as far as career is concerned. And that probably is because of the use of the other side, right? The combination of the emotional quotient versus intelligent quotient. Asta, we can go to the next slide. Yeah. So here we are. So we're talking about the emotional intelligence now. We talked earlier about emotional quotient. And we are talking about emotional intelligence here. So there is a slight difference between the emotional intelligence and emotional quotient. So what is the quotient? Quotient is a measure, right? Quotient is essentially tells you the quantity. It tells you, how efficient you are with the emotional aspect. or an intelligent aspect, right? Quotient is a measure. So I know emotionally how strong you are. But emotional intelligence is how do you combine your thinking of your feelings to build an authentic relationship to make good decisions, right? So it is emotional intelligence is taking the emotional quotient to the next level and making it practical, making it business-like, and making it, using it to your advantage and making it to use in such a way that you achieve the result that you want to achieve. And that's where, you know, you should always remember people use emotional quotient and emotional intelligence interchangeably. So you have to first of all understand the difference between the quotient and the emotional. EI and EQ are different inherently. And I always, you know, famously would like to see emotional intelligence and emotional quotient, the difference between the two is intelligence. Correct? I think, you know, that's a very, very critical aspect of the emotional intelligence. So here, Asta is helping us to understand all the three aspects of what is emotional intelligence versus the earlier IQ and EQ. So IQ, again, is a measure, as I said, quotient is a measure. Is a measure of how intelligent you are, right? So if you go to the, I was yesterday trying to take the intelligent quotient test, you know, and I think there are some 20 questions and I could go through about 10 odd questions. I just wanted to demonstrate to my daughters, you know, how intelligent I am, but I couldn't go past, you know, the 10th question. I didn't have the patient. There are a lot of logical questions. There's a bit of an arithmetic involved there. So that basically tells or determines how intelligent you are. Emotional quotient likewise, you know, determines the kind of, you know, social skills that you have, right? And again, as I spoke earlier, EI is a practical ability of using the emotional capabilities that you have. You know, I like the way, you know, Asta, you have put it in the emotional quotient description. Emotional quotient is one can still do stupid things, emotionally speaking, right? You know, the people who can be, just because you have a high emotional quotient doesn't necessarily make you a success, right? You need to basically use advantage. It's something like, you know, for you to, you know, cut a tree, that they say you need to have a great axe, right? But you should also know how to use that axe, right? So it's something like this. So you have the requisite skill in terms of emotional quotient or intelligent quotient, but, you know, EI is basically having also the intelligence to take it to the next level, to use it to your advantage, to get the desired results, ladies and gentlemen. So here we are on the emotional intelligence, and this is one of the definitions which we have derived, and you can probably, you know, look up to the emotional intelligence, and you know, you can you know, see this definition which is available. This is, you just go and ask the Google Baba or Alexa to give you a definition, and this is the definition probably which will pop up. It's the capability of individuals to recognize their own emotions and those of others. You know, the most critical aspect of it is, you know, recognizing the emotion, not only about your, not only your own, but also those of others, discern between the different feelings. Discern is basically the ability to differentiate between the different feelings within yourself and within the others and label them appropriately. Use emotional information to guide thinking and behavior and manage and or adjust emotion to adapt the environment to achieve one's goal. And as I was saying, the whole idea of, you know, the emotional intelligence is, you know, recognizing your own feelings, recognizing the feelings of other person, and then, you know, using the same to achieve the kind of a result one wants to achieve. It's an art, ladies and gentlemen, and I think it comes to you with a practice. But I believe that, I think, you know, there are things that, you know, one could achieve, and there are things that one could learn. So the question, the next slide talks about, you know, developing AI. A lot of people who ask me, Anil, you know, is it possible to develop AI? And the question is, you know, there is nothing in this world which cannot be learned, right? And I think, you know, as long as you have the enthusiasm, zeal, and ability, and the required, you know, basic knowledge and aptitude, I think you can learn everything under the sun. And I think, you know, there is no age limit for you to basically do. So I'm going to look at this particular, just a second before we start. So we are just going to look at this particular, you know, film, which we have, you know, taken it out from the open source. I'm going to share this with you. And this essentially, again, reinforces, you know, what we spoke about the emotional intelligence. And if, you know, it can be learned, it can be employed, and how do we do it? So I think, you know, we are taking this help of this particular thing, and we will discuss about this after going. This is a very short kind of a film for all of you. Ladies and gentlemen, a film on emotional intelligence for you. Ask the word to you, dear. Thank you.
Emotional intelligence refers to the ability to recognize, interpret, and process emotions in yourself and others. While genetics, upbringing, and environment all play a role, there are steps you can take to develop your emotional intelligence over time. Get to know yourself. Emotionally intelligent people are self-aware. They have a realistic appreciation of their strengths and weaknesses and how they come across to others. Peer feedback is one way of improving your self-awareness and may uncover a few of your emotional blind spots. Learn your triggers. Linked to the notion of self-awareness is knowing how you are likely to respond in particular situations. About how you felt the last time you were under pressure. Did these feelings help or hinder you? Recognizing emotions and the source of these emotions can shift your emotional state. Empathize. Seeing things from someone else's perspective will help you understand their values and beliefs. This is important when it comes to motivating and engaging others. Make a conscious effort to get to know your colleague. Ask open questions and actively listen to what they have to say, rather than simply waiting for your turn to speak. Be on the lookout for body language and other non-verbal signs, as these may tell you more than someone is willing to express out loud. Own your emotions. Part of being emotionally intelligent is about taking responsibility for the way you interact with others. If someone upsets you, pause and reflect on why their actions led you to feel this way instead of reacting impulsively. Recognize that a conversation is a two-way interaction, and it takes two people to make you angry, sad, or frustrated. Go with your gut. Finally, listen to your body. If your stomach starts doing backflips every time you speak to a senior manager, or your muscles tense up before you go into a meeting, what does this tell you? Counterintuitive as in, emotions can be a valuable source of information when making rational decisions at work. Remember, emotional intelligence isn't about suppressing emotions. It's about learning how to recognize, process, and channel them in a way that benefits you and your team. Enhancing your emotional intelligence requires effort, but it can be achieved with sustained practice.
Thank you, Asta. And I think, you know, that was a bit of introduction about, you know, emotional intelligence. And one other element which, you know, I would like to basically, you know, again, talk about it. It basically, you know, involves these particular elements, you know, the empathy, social skills, self-awareness, self-regulation, and motivation. Why we speak about it? Kindly know that, you know, it basically is harping on, you know, recognizing and appreciating not only your emotion, but the emotion of other person, right, with your whom you are interacting. See, you know, if for you to being successful, you need to understand and appreciate one thing. There is nothing, and I'm repeating, nothing that you can do in this world alone. you would always need support of other people, support and active support, right? So it's and you see around. I think this session would not have been possible without the help of Sir Prabhakar. I could not have put this presentation without the help of Asta, who is with me. And so you just go around and see everything that get executed successfully. You would always see the collaboration of people working towards to make it happen. All by one person, the results don't happen. And a lot of you are students here, and that's something which I want to park with you. Please understand, never ever, irrespective of whatever level that you reach, you would be in a position to claim success all by yourself. So you would need to remain humble, right, and thankful and respectful, and everything that is in your gift to be recognizing that particular aspect, that your success is not your success, but is a function of collaboration, is a function of other people supporting you. And how would the other people support you is basically understanding, appreciating them. I think I hear so many people so many times, and I've seen even my children talking. I have two daughters, by the way, and they get into this conversation. That person behaved, that person was so wrong. And I try to intervene and say, there's nothing about any person wrong, right? It is a belief system or the value system that the other person demonstrates that you may not agree with, but doesn't make that person or that word another approach is a wrong approach. It's only a different approach. And as long as you are clinical, objective in seeing things that way, and you understand and empathize. Empathize, is some word which essentially I just love, right? To be in somebody else's shoes. It's easily said. Try to practice it. I think all of my batch people are above 50, and we are trying to figure it out in terms of achieving that. I think among our batchmates also, we have people whom we feel are not matured enough, and they are about 55 years old. And so that should tell you that I think the travel to maturity is not easy. I think one needs to continuously learn. One needs to continuously acquire skills and make it a success. So coming back to the element of elements that are there. So these are five critical elements that are there of emotional intelligence, right? Empathy, social skills, self-awareness, self-regulation, and motivation. And basically, since I'm talking to the people from HR fraternity, and you are all going to be, if not the HR professionals, and associated with HR. I think anything and everything of this element has to do with all that we will do as HR people, right? Be it an appraisal, I think you would need to employ one of these elements: employee engagement, conflict management, organizational development, maybe even talent management and resourcing, change management. Change management is a big deal in organizations today, and even employee development in form of training. Unless and until you have the emotional intelligence capability, or essentially you have the elements which go into the emotional intelligence that essentially get employed, you will not see success in any of the things that you do in terms of the HR majors or the HR initiatives that you want to take. I think this is something which I have observed over a period of time. And to be honest, most of the things, I think, be it empathy, social skills, I think, we have a natural ability to imbibe those, and we have it, right? From the value system, our even families tell us to respect the elders, listen, appreciate other person's point. These are all essentially nothing but tips towards becoming more adept at emotional intelligence. But I think for you to become professional, and to you becoming professionally successful, I think it is important to invest in studying the subject further. So you need to be a little clinical, you need to devote time, you need to understand the subject and make that conscious of effort in terms of shifting the focus from yourself to the other person, right? Make the other person at the center of the conversation. And I think you would be in a position to find a solution to the kind of challenges and the problems that you would have, right? Ask the next slide. All right, so there we go. So how many of you guys have heard of Yaksha Prashna? Now it's one story, but I think, you know, I'm going to share this particular story. And this is a story which I love. And I whenever there's an opportunity, you know, I like to quote this particular story. So all of you would be aware of Mahabharata, right? I think, you know, as they call Mahabharata. So I think, you know, this story of, you know, a fascinating story of Pandavas, right? And this particular, the story on the Yaksha Prashna, I'm sure, you know, some of you might be aware about the story. But I think you need to humor me for next few minutes as I essentially take you through this particular story. You know, I think the Pandavas went through their Vanvas, right? You know, the 12 years of Vanvas. And I think, you know, you also know the story behind why they went into the Vanvas, right? And how Yudhishthira lost the plot and then essentially were sent to the Vanvas, and everybody, including, you know, Draupadi, actually had to, you know, go through the penance for the 12 years. So this particular story, actually, Yaksha Prashna story, belongs to the, you know, if you read Mahabharata, I think, you know, there are different parvas. So this particular story is essentially attributed at the end of the Mahabharata, end of the Aranya Parva. So end of the 12 years of penance that they're undergoing through their stay in the Aranyas, right? So this particular story talks about you know, five brothers, you know, getting exhausted, and there is a prelude to the story in terms of, I think, you know, the some rishis, and they come and they are basically looking for some kind of, you know, pious wood and some flowers and then durvas, etc. And they ask you know, and then somebody stolen that, a deer essentially, you know, takes it away as it gets stuck into its horns. And they try to chase it and then get it back. In the process, they get tired. And Yudhishthira then, you know, asks, you know, the youngest of the lot, the brothers, you know, Nakula and the Sahadeva, the youngest, to, you know, go and get some water, right? And there is the riverit which is close by. There is a water body which is close by, which he requests the youngest brothers, you know, one after the other to go. So one doesn't come, Nakula doesn't come, then he sends Sahadev. And he also doesn't come back, right? And then he sends Bhima. And then Bhima also doesn't come back, right? And then he sends Arjuna, right? No, Arjuna also doesn't come back. And then he realizes that there is something wrong that has happened. I've sent these guys only to get some water, and we are all thirsty here. Why these guys have not come back? And then he actually goes to the river to find all his brothers lying dead. So Nakula, Sahadeva, Bhima, and Arjuna, he finds all of them dead. And he realizes in an instant that this is some kind of you know, a stronger force. And something to do with, you know, godly act, because he knows that all his four brothers are extremely brave and extremely strong. So it is not easy for anybody to kill them or defeat them as such. So he prays, you know, to the water, hey God, I know that, you know, my brothers would have offended or whatever. I just want to apologize on their behalf. So I think even before the God gives the actually, you know, shows its own form, essentially he has taken the form, as the story says, of a crane. Crane is a bird, and in Marathi you call it bagla, and that basically the crane basically is talking to Yudhishthira that, you know, you first need to, you know, answer my questions. And then basically, you know, you can touch the water. And then he says that, no, I had told your brother not to touch the water. Even Nakula or Sadeva, the crane had told that if you touch the water, you will be dead. And they just ignored it. When Bhima came, they also told Bhima that don't touch the water. He said, let me first take the water. And he says, so before taking the water, you need to answer my questions. He said, let me take the water and then I will answer your questions because we are thirsty. And the same thing happened with Arjuna, and all of them die because the crane says that they didn't listen to my advice. And then Yudhishthira says, in all humbleness, I apologize on their behalf, I'm not here to steal any water. We're just simple people, trying to quench our thirst. And please give me your darshan. And then this dharma actually comes along. And he says, I had even warned them that, if they take my water without my permission, that they will face the consequences. And they have faced the consequences. It is their act and their behavior that led to their death. And if you want the water, you will have to answer my questions. And then the question answer session starts. And it is called, the riddles that are being asked. I think I will ask you guys through that riddle. Some of the questions are very, very pertinent and interesting even in this day and age. And those are the question shrunkala, which is called the shrunkala of Yaksha Prashna. So a lot of time, we also talk about Yaksha Prashna was this, right? Yaksha Prashna is a tricky question. And then those are all the tricky questions. And the sets of tricky questions were asked by Dharmaraj and Yudhishthir, to his credit, patiently, obediently, in all humbleness, he answers all the questions. And at the end of the question answer session, the Dharmaraj becomes very happy with a behavior, humbleness, and intelligence demonstrated by Yudhishthir. And then he says, I'm very, very happy. And as a bonus, I would allow you to ask for any one brother's life back. And then Yudhishthira asks for I think Nakula's life, and because the logic being, and then Dharmaraj asks, why are you asking his life? He's the youngest and probably the weakest. Bhima is somebody whom you love. And Arjuna is somebody whom you go to when it comes to war, but you've chosen Nakula. But as Yudhishthira also had his stepmother. So while Kunti was the mother of Yudhishthira, Bhima, and Arjuna, his stepmother essentially said that Nakula was. His stepmother also should have a brother, and hence I can't go and face her while my mother would have a son in me. How can I face my other mother when she asks what about my son? And then hence I want his. So that answer also impresses Dharmaraj, and he gives the life of all these brothers back. So all the brothers who were dead are alive again, right? And then they have all the water that they want, Yudhishthira's, and I call the behavior of Yudhishthira, and then this is something the way I see it, a behavior which is which employs emotional intelligence, right? I think he demonstrates everything. Right. He's emotionally connected and he appreciates, and he's also intelligent, right? The questions which Dharmaraj asks him are not an easy question. So obviously, he has to have a lot of intelligence in terms of answering those questions. But he has that prudence, that ability to value the kind of momentary importance of the engagement. And he engages with Dharmaraj in that manner. He demonstrates he's thankful, he's very respectful, and he doesn't offend. Whereas all those four people, they offend the crane, right? And And the least that they could have done was, you know, not to touch the water, right? Irrespective of that, they went and did that, and that's the reason they end up becoming dead. And this is what happens to us in our corporate career, correct? We don't see the warnings, and we end up being, you know, not as much successful as the Yudhishthir was, right? I think, you know, I'm sure, you know, other brothers would also done equally better in terms of their attempt to answer the questions. But I think, you know, they failed in recognizing what the situation is demanding. And this is how I see, and this is always what, you know, I would want you to remember and recall the story of Yakshaprashna and how, you know, Yudhishthir single-handedly got back the lives of all his brothers. While, you know, he sees, this is an example of how one could be emotionally significantly interested, interesting. I'm also, you know, reminded of his behavior in first place when he actually gets into gambling with his other brothers, right? With Shakuni Mama and the Duryodhans, and how he loses the plot, including everything, right? And ends up in first place in this vanvas of 12 years. So that is again another behavior of not being able to demonstrate the kind of, you know, adeptness that you would require, right? Probably at that point in time, as Asta had put it in the slide earlier, you know, he had a high level of emotional quotient. He was respectful and he wanted to stay committed to his promises. But, you know, he lacked the judgment. He lacked the intelligence which was required at that point in time. He should not have gambled his way through. He should not have gambled his wife. He should not have gambled his Raj and everything, right? I think, you know, that incident in my mind actually created paved way for the Mahabharata that actually happened subsequently. So here is, ladies and gentlemen, my interpretation of how emotional intelligence can bring you back to the life, or for that matter, how lack of emotional intelligence can send you to the vanvas of failure, right? I've seen people who have mishandled situations, mishandled bosses, and, you know, have literally derailed their careers. And they have literally gone on the vanvas of this, you know, 10, 12 years, which our five friends along with the Draupadi went through. So don't do that harakiri. It just essentially takes that one kind of incident to, you know, take away all that you have learned. Never be arrogant, right? You know, always remain humble, remain respectful. I think, you know, please remember that, you know, everything is temporary, you know, your positions. And all of us, from my batch, we have been in this field of human resources and we have been in a very, very senior position for about past few decades, right? And one of the things that, you know, we have learned in the hard way, that the people, you know, I think, you know, the pride essentially will take you down. Arrogance will essentially not take you further. In the process of pride and arrogance, you'll only create enemies, right? I think, you know, pride, arrogance, you know, super confident, not being able to, these are essentially self-focused things. And I said earlier, the center of attention has to be the other person. So whenever you are engaging in a conversation, or for that matter, communicating, the other person and his interest, his feeling, they should always be, you know, at the center stage. And you find a fault in that, you need to work towards addressing that particular aspect before, going forward. As I said earlier again, that, you know, there's nobody who is wrong. I think, you know, people have a different view, and fundamentally you need to respect that view. Asta, can we move on to the next slide? So here we go. I think, you know, the emotional intelligence, as I said, you know, have certain, you know, implications in terms of, you know, what we do as leaders, right? It basically, you know, again, talking about the story of Yudhishthira, which we talk about foresight. He had that kind of ability and foresight, right, in terms of what would have happened. And then he remained humble, he remained calm. You know, he was innovative in his strategizes, actions going forward. He anticipated the problem, the questions, and how he sees the opportunity. When he asked the question, I will make this thing. He again, you know, employed the right kind of, you know, answer in terms of, you know, getting the life of the weakest of his brother back. And he flawlessly executed everything. He answered one question after the other. You know, he basically managed, you know, the team cohesion. You know, he was naturally able to relate to Dharmaraj also, right, in his question answer session. And he was highly receptive, highly humble. So what makes all these qualities? You know, these are the qualities that make you a strategic leader. A strategic leader is the one who is able to have a foresight on what is going to happen. He knows where you stand and he knows where you want to go. And he also knows how he's going to manage that journey from point A to point B. And that journey is nothing but the change capability. Essentially, whatever the changes that one needs to basically incorporate. And as long as you have that kind of an ability among the leaders in your firms, in the organizations that you work for, you develop that distinct competitive advantage. You would have heard about the USP, unique selling proposition for the product, but an organization, you need the competitive advantage, A, for succeeding, and B, for survival and sustenance of the performance of the organization. You as an HR person can bring a lot to the table in ensuring an organization remains vibrant, an organization remains efficient, an organization remains productive, right? That is your role as an HR person, a very, very large role of supporting and ensuring that the business stays in the right course, it stays in the right direction, and it's managed flawlessly. Asta, do we have any slide any further than this? All right, so I think, we talked about the competitive advantage and how does the emotional intelligence, allows us to create that competitive advantage. Obviously, if you're adept at emotional intelligence, you facilitate a better efficiency, and efficiency leads to productivity. You will see, an organization, is producing more, but not tired, right? An organization producing more, working efficiently, and the workers are engaged and motivated because you are able to relate to their needs and wants. And since you understand their needs and wants, the workforce and the people or the resources or the stakeholders that are working with you, they develop a kind of a trust in the management. And when you develop a trust in you, you kind of establish a credibility. Credibility is a belief system that you will do no wrong and you will take care of them. And you will essentially, create a significant amount of engagement. And when you have this kind of a trust and efficiency and productivity by your side, you create a tremendous amount of agility in the organization. Agility is ability to move quickly and correct. And that's where the course correction is. When you're trying to achieve something, if you face hindrance, you should be in a position to circumvent, right? And I think you won't be in a position to do that unless and until you have that inherent ability to agile, awareness that you have, which is built into the organization. So this is what the emotional intelligence, ladies and gentlemen, brings to you. And to make a last point, it is very important to understand that emotional intelligence is not the opposite of intelligence. You read it along with the intelligence, and it is not a triangle heart or the head, and it is the unique intersection of both, right? And I like that word, emotional intelligence, because it has, it acknowledges both of the critical element of anybody's persona. So ladies and gentlemen, that was a big thank you from me to you, and thank you, Asta, for putting this story together for me. And it was a pleasure talking to you. And over to you, and you can ask any question under the sun about emotional intelligence. I have Vivek Bhatavadekar with me, who has studied more of emotional intelligence than me. I can also take his help in answering your questions. Ladies and gentlemen, to you, more than happy to hear you and answer your questions. And need not, your answer to the questions need not be limited to emotional intelligence. You can ask me any other question that you have.
Well, thank you, Anil sir, for your deep insight on the emotional intelligence. So we will be having our question and answer session now. So yes. Participants can post their questions in the Q&A session, And meanwhile, Rajesh sir can take over and moderate the question and answer session. Rajesh sir, please.
Yeah, good evening, everybody. Good evening, Anil.
Hey, good evening, Rajesh. I'm sorry, I didn't know that you're also around. I couldn't see. Rajesh is a dear friend of mine. And I think, thank you so very much, Rajesh, for coming along.
So I think it was quite thought-provoking presentation. Many of the concepts, including me, I think we have learned it for the first time. And I think whatever we have seen now, it will definitely, we will go back and revisit all our assumptions, theories, you know. It was such a thought-provoking thing. And we must all revisit. Meanwhile, I have a couple of questions here came on Q&A chat.
Sure.
First one is, in coming years, it is put by some anonymous attendee. The person says, in coming years, there will be a situation where AI will take up many jobs, making many people jobless. How should an HR professional deploy emotional intelligence while dealing with this situation? Also, the same person has put further question, to what degree introspection and retrospection play a part to become emotional intelligence? So maybe first one.
Yes. So now I think, you know, Rajesh, take the second question first. I think you answered the fundamental question. And when we talked about, you know, emotional intelligence, we talked about, you know, emotional intelligence is nothing but, you know, understanding your own feeling and also the feeling of other person. So introspection is built into the being emotional intelligence. So you have to be introspective, which will essentially help you to recognize and acknowledge your own thought process and feeling. So what emotional intelligence also talks about is being, you know, respectful and acknowledgement in acknowledging the other person's feelings as well. So I think, you know, that's something which is given. But coming back to the first question, I know artificial intelligence and how it is, going to affect us. You know, artificial intelligence is nothing but, you know, advancement of technology, right? You know, it is basically you're going from one phase to others. And the course correction or the technology change, this is not the first time that a technology change is happening, correct? I think while, it will move to the next technology. So I think, you know, the first industrial revolution, if you see that happened, everything, you know, moved, you know, the wheels got introduced, people thought, you know, what's going to happen to the earlier technology. But no, I think, you know, it generates its own career kind of, you know, choices. But yes, I think it is emotional intelligence is where you need to use is to acknowledge the kind of, you know, transition that is going to happen in the industry, correct? As a leader, the business leader, you have to basically recognize the fact that, you know, the technology changes are going to happen. Today it's in AI. Tomorrow it is going to be something else, and day after tomorrow something else, right? And a change is the only constant, as they say. And I think, you know, you don't have to be overly worried, right? I think, you know, technology will be there. Technology will come along, while, you know, certain jobs will go away. Right? You know, when typewriters essentially went away and the computers came, a lot of people thought that, you know, we had a lot of IR issues or labor problems when the machine, computers came and the introduction of, you know, computers was trying to be done at that point in time in the companies and in the banks. And there was a lot of resistance in terms of, you know, people losing jobs, but that didn't happen, right? I think, you know, people should embrace the new skills and the technology. While, you know, certain jobs, and then something which, you know, I've written another article and which I've said that what's going to happen is, you know, the jobs don't get redundant. Competencies do, right? The skill sets do. The typewriting ability would go away, or the somebody who has the ability to repair a typewriter, that skill set would be of a lesser value. But that person should, you know, learn to repair maybe a computer and he will stay relevant. And the same thing applies to all of us and the HR professionals as well. We need to always, you know, stay adept at our own competence and technology, right? And all of us, when we started our careers you know, the computers 30 years ago, the computers were just introduced, right? You know, and today I think, you know, we are basically in the, I'm basically locked on here and adopted the technology. I'm on an iPad and we use an iPhone. And then we are total, and last about 7 months, I'm working from home. Now I'm in my office, I'm actually in my branch office. But yes, I think, you know, one needs to, you know, recognize that the technology is here, change is here to stay. And I think, you know, one need not fear. I think, you know, it's constant. You know, something or other will keep on happening. Skill sets will become redundant. And that's where, you know, you as HR professional will also need to be, you know, conscious of that and keep on adding to your own skill sets and also facilitate that change in other people. So just to give you an example, I have also adding up, you know, continuously to my own competencies and skill set. Last year, I attended a business management course of 1 year from IIM Calcutta. So the course entitled me to, you know, go to the IIM Calcutta campus for about 8 days every quarter. So you need to invest, right? You know, I could take that time out and I told my firm that this is what I want to do. And when you actually, you know, try to do something which is in the interest of yourself and the firm sees that this is when you add certain skill set to yourself, that skill set is essentially going to help organizations well. But you need to have that conviction. And nobody comes in and tells you, go and develop yourself. You need to figure it out yourself. Yeah. I hope I have answered your question. Mr. Anonymous. Rajesh, any other question?
Which is, what are steps to be taken to improve emotional intelligence?
I think, you know, we just went through that particular presentation, right? I don't know. Who is asking that question?
Yeah, one of the anonymous.
Yeah. Arey Baba, we employed that the video clip, right? It only talks about how do we, you know, improve. The whole idea of showing that particular video clip was to, you know, demonstrate how does, you know, one improve the emotional intelligence. It's a, as it said, you know, it's a lot of practice. It's a step-by-step approach. It involves, you know, essentially yourself and more importantly other people's feelings. So I think, you know, you need to basically invest a lot into it. You know, for you to be, you know, the easiest way to become super successful emotionally is, you know, become selfless. You know, easy said and done. You know, it's a very natural instinct which comes into human to, you know, look after yourself, right? You know, you try to save yourself first. That's an actual instinct. Try to, you know, save somebody else first. You know, try to think about somebody else whenever or whatever you're doing, and you would be there, right? You know, it's just simply put, and then work towards it. Always in any conversation, in any action, try to think about other persons first, and you know, even at the cost of your own interest. And that's how you establish the credibility. That's how people would start respecting you.
I think, Anil, you made a very, very important point. You know, think of others also, yeah, as well. And many, yeah, people walk over all the place and, you know, other people. And that causes trouble in the team, ranks and files, you know. We have seen cases. Now,
yes, just Rajesh, to give another example, you know, to, yeah, and then when, you know, so in an organization, so we from HR, we deal with, you know, the compensation and rewards and the benefit process, right? The year end, you know, I come across different type of managers where, you know, they say that he wants his team to get this kind of increments or this kind of bonuses, and the organization would say, no, you know, this is the kind of, you know, limit within which you would need to operate. We can't give you more than 6%, 10% increase or whatever. And I have come across managers who would say, okay, there are managers who would fight tooth and nail, nothing doing, you know, they've worked hard and stuff like that. There are managers also, you know, they'll fight hard, and if that is not working, they say, you know what, do one thing, you know, what are the bonus that is available to me, you know, why don't you, you know, give it to that other person, or whatever, don't give me the increment, but, you know, give that money to the other person. I believe that person deserves it, and if it doesn't get, I will lose the credibility, you know. So there are people, so ask the question, do you have that ability to say ki boss mere ko mat dena pagar bada ke but mere subordinate ko dena agar utna conviction nahi hai to I think you know it's you're not yet there.
Right.
So you should always ask that litmus test. Are you willing to sacrifice yourself in terms of are you magnanimous enough in terms of sacrificing your own personal interest in the interest of others?
Anil, I think again, well said. There is one important question: is there any measurement scale like IQ or many of the, you know, there are plethora of other psychometric test. So for this emotional intelligence, what are the, or if there are any good measuring scales?
Yeah, I think there would be, Rajesh. You know, I don't have, but I think there are it will basically tell you in terms of, you know, there are various, you know, objective tools which you would also be aware, right? You know, in terms of where do you stand in terms of your ability to correlate, right? You know, so though it might not give you quotient exact, you know, marks on, you know, on a 100 point scale, you know, where do you stand, but essentially at least there are certain tests which can give you the orientation that you have. So you, whether you have an people and external orientation and the selflessness orientation, if you have that, I think, you know, you would basically, you know, safely you can conclude that you are adept at emotional intelligence. But only challenge, Rajesh, with the test is, you know, many a times, you know, the tests are fooled by our responses. As the responses, you know, typically when we take these tests, the responses are towards, and especially the subjective test, right? And objective, of course, anyways, you need to answer them correctly. But when it comes to measuring, you know, something like, you know, the quality that you have, generally people, you know, answer it in a manner to assuming how they would want to be and not what, you know, they actually are. Because they think that they are accommodative. Wow, would you help him? Yes, I would. I'm very helpful. But truly, you know, what he is and what he thinks he is, there is a gap between the two. So there are very few tests which we can actually recognize that gap and, you know, identify that fallacy. So one needs to be very careful while, you know, taking the test on this. And one needs to essentially, you know, dilute the kind of a result and question the result in terms of how the person would have responded. I think, you know, the coaching and the counseling are the better measures, I think, you know, in terms of dealing with or improving the aspect of emotional intelligence. I have in past used the coaches, right? So in terms of improving the ability of people to, you know, become better managers.
Anil, you know, questions are, the question coming. One more, I think, we need to address the question is, how would you validate a person, you know, who or he or she has scaled up from certain level of intelligence to a new level? Suppose you have, or like we in HR have to judge a person who's at X level and we know the improvement areas. Because in when we talk about performance improvement, we discuss many attributes of the person, right? And we said KPIs like that. So is it possible in case of emotional intelligence, you know, how to judge a person by calling, he or she is a poor in EI, and after some time, when person shows improvement with certain aspects or attributes, can we judge a person saying that he and she has definitely improved up level on EI?
I think surely. I think, you know, it's not going to be Rajesh, the person has improved on EI, but I think you can always say that whether the person is more acceptable to the team, right? And then that's something which is essentially indicate that the person has recognized and acknowledge the criticality of the relationship, and that you can conclude is nothing but he's employing AI. This, in my personal experience, you know, I think the 360 degrees evaluation would come in pretty handy in terms of, you know, assessing the journey of an individual from point A to point B. I think, you know, beginning of the process, I think you can always and all of us, I'm assuming that you know what 360 degrees evaluation process is all about. It is evaluation of the feedback which is received from all the stakeholders that you are interacting with. That will include your subordinate, your peers, your superiors, and even the ones who essentially are away from you, including your vendors or whoever. And then they basically give you an independent feedback in terms of their experience with you. So you can, you know, understand that experience at a particular point, you know, point A. And after, you know, and you give that feedback to that particular individual that this is, listen, brother, you know, this has been the kind of, you know, feedback about you. And typically I have seen that, you know, most of the time when the 360-degree feedback, you know, comes to the people, and they are so surprised with the kind of feedback they receive, because, you know, what they think that they are and what people think that they are, there's always this, you know, significant gap between the two. So you recognize that, so you introduce that gap to them. And then, you know, you can probably tell him how he has to fix the gap, work with him. And that development process, I think you can have your coach assigned to him, or you can, you know, give that assistance to him, or training or development. And the first step of the development plan is that feedback process, and an objective one at that. The moment you are able to do it, I think the journey of, you know, change starts. And then you can, at a point of maybe after a year or six months after a continuous kind of process, you can again run the same process, get the feedback from people, and assess where has he undergone any change from where he was earlier to now, as you are finding about him after all the interventions that have happened. And you can actually find out, you know, the kind of change that would have happened there.
Anil, there is one question from Ms. Cynthia. She's asking how to look at this emotional intelligence considering environment as well as from perspective of handling work-life balance. Any specific insights?
I think, you know, emotionally intelligent people are, you know, they make life a little easier. You know, the moment you are emotionally adept, I think your, and my personal experience is, your stress level typically goes down. I think you are able to, you know, see the things in a very different kind of a perspective. As I said earlier, right, you know, you don't find anybody's behavior wrong. The moment you find anybody's behavior wrong, that again puts you into very, very discomfortable kind of, you know, situation in your thoughts. It also puts you in stress that, you know, the person is behaving irrationally, and it becomes, you know, very, very irritating to you. But the moment you change the outlook and you don't find any other behavior of other person irrational or irritating, I think you are at ease with that, and you are acknowledging his behavior. He's behaving because he has an issue, or he behaves in a particular manner. That's what the system is essentially telling him to do. And you start introspective in a very objective manner. And that essentially relaxes you. I think, you know, to my mind, you become a better human being, you better manager, you become a better family man when you are able to, you know, develop that emotional intelligence. I think it is significantly required even in your personal life. At the same time, you know, Rajesh, I'm also always surprised. There are people who behave in a particular manner at home and behave in a very, very different manner when they are in office. And so they put up a kind of a show, right? So they might be, I think, you know, all of us and all men and then women, we know at home we are extremely tolerant. Our tolerance is very, very different being dealing with children, right? You know, your tolerance has to be significantly at a different level. But at the office environment, your tolerance goes down. You know, I'm not able to understand why that happens, right? If you're tolerant at home, you can might as well be tolerant even in office. Or for that matter, you know, if you're tolerant in office, you might as well be tolerant at home as well, right? I think, you know, and that's where I think, you know, you should take learnings from both places. Become pragmatic and become acknowledging, you know. And from there, I think, you know, we can lead a better professional as well as personal life. I hope I have answered the question.
Yes, there are many questions still coming in.
So we can quickly go through the questions.
Yes, I think one question is from Mr. Samir Bhamre. His question is, empathy is important, but in an organizational setup, if associate is troubled and we understand that it is hampering, I mean, he may not be emotionally able to handle those situations, how to make use of
I couldn't hear you.
Counseling or...
No, I couldn't understand the question.
Question is, empathy is important. That is what we learn in EI.
Yes,
right?
Yes.
Especially when one of the associates is troubled. And in order to help him out, how to make use of emotional intelligence to help him overcome it?
I think, you know, the first step is, you know, as you said, rightly said, you know, so having the right amount of empathy, recognition is nothing but you having emotional intelligence, right? So if you have that, I think you're already employing that. You're recognizing that, you know, that person needs help. Itself is a help, right? You know, the problem is when you don't acknowledge that somebody needs help and you're not able to appreciate the situation or the challenges that particular individual is facing. The fact that you're able to recognize that, the fact that you're able to understand that particular aspect is itself, you know, a big, significant help as far as that particular individual is concerned. And I think, you know, let us be, you know, pragmatic here, Rajesh. We being HR, we are not going to be the people who are going to solve all the problems of all the people, correct? I think, you know, our job is restricted to understanding, keeping the efficiency in the organization, keeping the engagement level high. But there comes the situation that actually, you know, you should allow the person to, you know, take an external help, be it coach, be it, you know, health expert, be it counselors. I think we cannot do everything all the time. I think we should allow that person to, you know, seek some external help, expert help in dealing with, you know, problems. Right? There are people who are significant troublemakers, right? And you know, as an HR person, what you would do to that kind of a person. So I think, all the solution doesn't lie with us as an HR person. I think, you know, we need to also learn to basically hand over the challenge and the issue to the right kind of people.
Anil, one very last question. It's about taking ethical decisions, right? Sometimes there are overwhelming business considerations.
Correct.
On the other side, there are real employee grievances. And we have our inner voice, our mind tells us, no, this situation has to be addressed in a business scenario. But many times it is not permitted. You know, many times, or I would say most of the times, business consideration overrules everything else. So in that situation, how to is not ethical decisions at the logger or emotional intelligence.
Correct. I think, you know, and then you ask a very, very you know, critical kind of a question, right? And I think when the chips are down, when the situations are extremely difficult, you know, and what you're saying is, you know, you as an organization are not also able to help the individual, correct? I think, you know, there might be a case where it is not the fault of the individual or the workman, but I think, you know, you are facing as an organization the issue and the challenge. How do you, you know, manage the situation? And I'll give an example. When I was in RPS, and you know, the globally, I think, you know, there was a financial industry crisis, the Abra Bank, where I used to work, and I was head of HR, I was taken over by RPS, and then subsequently I became the head of HR for RPS. I think they decided to close the operations in India, where they decided, because globally they were not able to support it, and they decided, because the government bailed it out, and one of the conditions that they, the bailout was that they will shrink from non-core market, as in non-Europe market, during this year. Operation. So we had, you know, direct and indirect employees put together, there's some 7,000-8,000. And I had to plan, and I think, you know, I had executed a plan where about, you know, 4,000 to 5,000 people will let go on the phase one itself. Now it was, you know, extremely difficult decision, right? Now, where does the emotional intelligence, you know, comes into play here? You know, it and then that's where I kept on telling people, I think, you know, I believe that, you know, I tried to manage and do the kind of, you know, scale down in the most human way that is possible. I went and fought in the organization to give all the time that people needed, and I went on telling people that, you know, to find a job, etc., and created an enabling kind of a program to help them, you know, settle down in new course. I could build that confidence that I think, you know, they train themselves and then they try it out. The experience that they have had only will get them the better roles and better jobs. And in my experience, almost significant number only became better off with better remuneration and better jobs in the industry. So it's a question of how you manage. You know, even if you are emotionally AI enabled, I think you are in a position to manage challenging situation in a far, far better manner than somebody who would be not adept at that. Yeah. So and that has been my example, and that's something which I remember very clearly. And I feel that, you know, me being there, I really made a difference to those people and that organization. I remember, you know, fighting and asking the organization, giving people time to 6 months, 8 months, 9 months, till the time, you know, they could get a job. So I think your conviction essentially, you know, helps you to fight the organization, right? But if you are void of that bit, it becomes, you'll just go ahead, the organization tell you, ask them, they are 1 month notice, give them 1 month notice, and, you know, ask them to go, and you go and execute it. I think, you know, that's, I don't think that there's any fun in it, right? I think, you know, you need to, you know, bring yourself in there on the table. And you know, try to facilitate the kind of, you know, change program that you want to manage in the most human way possible. What emotional intelligence, you know, calls for is, you know, dealing with the situation humanly. And I keep on asking that question: was I human enough in terms whenever I've interacted or dealt with any situation? And you ask that question, and I think we'll get that answer. You know, and human beings are capable of having this conversation with oneself, right? I don't know how many animals can have that conversation. Like, you know, you can sit in one place and you can do the question answer session. Okay, boss Anil, would you do this? No, I don't think I will do it. You know, so you can have that conversation and the chat and the talk with yourself. I don't think that any other animal is blessed with that. So you can have and question your own actions, right? You're blessed with that, and I think that ability, that blessing, you should, and all of us should use it very, very frequently. Asking questions to ourselves, yeah. And I think, you know, we can't lie to ourselves, right? We can lie to the whole world. How will you lie to yourself? Yeah. I hope Rahesh, my attempt to the question was
reasonable. No, I think interesting. I think we had what we need very, very interesting questions coming. So it shows that people have deep interest in the subject, and you know, they are asking very, very key questions. I mean, that way it will go on and on, but I think somewhere we may have to conclude. If you are able to take one very last question, which is on a recruitment, that while choosing right people for the right job, what would you go by? Is it by mere perception or anecdotal statistical data? Or both?
I think, you saw that earlier in the presentation, we showed you that iceberg, you know, what you can see on the top and what is underneath. So typically, whenever somebody comes to you for an interview, he tries to show you what he wants to show you to you, correct? He wants to show you that upper part of the iceberg, right? You know, this is what I am and this is what. So he, as a person, when he is essentially trying to, you know, sell you, he is not going to show you what he doesn't want you to want to see of him. Either his lacunas or his inabilities, his inexperience, he's certainly not going to, you know, they say he's going to put his best foot forward. And the foot which is not best, he's not going to put it forward. So that means he's not going to demonstrate. As an interviewer, I think, you know, it's your ability to understand and try to find out what he's like to not showing, right? And a simple question, simple way to deal with it is, you know, all of us do it, you know, we do the situational questioning, correct? We give the situation to the individual and ask him to solve it. So he is not structured, right? You know, you create a situation or create a challenge, but this is a challenge, how are you going to deal with it, right? You at least understand, you know, how is it going to approach. Of course, you know, again, the challenge with situational interviewing is, you know, basically he's anyways going to talk about what he would, you know, ideally want to do, but we don't know whether he would end up practically doing. So you ask him the challenging kind of situation that he would have faced. And you know, right, you know, you're looking at resume, you need to do a bit of a study, especially at a senior level, in terms of, you know, what are the situations or the challenges that he's faced and how he solved it. And when you're doing that, I think, you know, you should basically also, when you're doing the reference checks, I think you should validate those things which the interviewer would have answered. I think you'll get a fair bit of, you know, understanding by virtue of, you know, doing the reference checks by asking him. So what we generally do when we hire a senior person, we at least, the person is met at least by 5 to 6 people within the organization and at least twice. So about 8 to 10 interactions that happen, and after that, you know, the selection of a senior person happens. For example, when I was hired in JM, the selection went on for about, you know, 1.5-2 months. And uske baad mein, after I resigned and I asked them about 4 months because I was closing the RPS, right? So 3 months was my notice period, but I joined JM after 4.5 months. And also asked JM to give me permission to support RBS for additional couple of months because I had certain, you know, commitments there. So I think it's a very, very different kind of a process that, you know, you as an incumbent will deal with the situation and try to do. And having said this, you should, you know, understand and appreciate there is no tool in the world which will assess the individual, you know, correctly. And the reason being, you know, all of us are changing. While, you know, you're hiring somebody, he had a particular perspective that you were hiring. He had that particular perspective and you hired him for that. You as an organization are changing. Your challenges would have moved, right? You know, when I was hired in JM, I was basically hired to set up a bank. And JM was applying for banking license. And I came with an experience of leading a change management process in several of the banks. But I think we applied for the bank, but we didn't get the bank license. And the situation changed, the ask from me changed. So I also had to move on from, you know, setting up the bank to, you know, leading a business. So I lead a business for JM Financial now. So I think, you know, one is to, you know, as an incumbent has to change, organizational situation change. So it's a very dynamic situation of any individual becoming, you know, successful in any organization. And people develop, right? Just the way the organization develops. So I think, you know, you cannot fix it. There is no 100% guaranteed tool to measure individual, because, you know, what today he is, there is no assurance that he will be the same tomorrow and day after. Because, you know, human beings are very, very complex phenomena. And organizations are, you know, ever-changing dynamic situations. So that's where you are, right?
I think quite a thought-provoking. I think it answered, you answered very well most of the...
I tried it. There's no straight answer to a lot of questions.
Yeah, it's no. Good, sir. Rajesh, sir. Anil sir has very good clarity you have given.
Well, thank you so very much.
Thought promoting subject, and I think a lot of us will go back and think through, revisit our assumptions and fundamentals, and also look at the solutions in HR from new insights. I think all those question answers are over. I think I hand over
to you. Thank you so very much. Thank you once again to everybody. Thanks, Prabhakar. Thank you, sir. And thank you. Thanks to the Institute for giving this opportunity to be more than happy to come along and talk anytime that you would want. I go to, you know, whichever institute that calls me. And I'm selfless. You know, whatever I can share, I selflessly share, right? And I'm more than happy to share anything that you would want at any point.
Now we have come to the end of our today's session. Abhijit will give a vote of thanks. But I request you to the presentation you have presented here, you could share the copy of that presentation to all participants. So that would be good. So
I'll certainly share the presentation. Not a problem.
Share the presentation. So if at all, if there is any query, so many queries are there and people are still looking for the answers, but because of the time constraint, we cannot continue. But we'll forward these questions to you.
I'll be more than happy.
Manner, you just try to.
I will certainly answer those questions.
So with this, I request Abhijit, you can have the vote of thanks and then we can close.
Yeah. Thank you, Prabhakar, sir. Good evening to one and all. I am Abhijit Thatarak, and it is a great privilege for me to propose the vote of thanks on today's occasion. I would like to thank our today's honorable guest, Shri Anil Salvi sir, for delivering the lecture on emotional intelligence. His insights on emotional intelligence will definitely help us. Like he said that IQ is the tip of an iceberg. What lies underneath is the EQ. And the triumph of heart over head, which is the emotional intelligence and the opposite of intelligence. So it's an unique intersection of both. I also like to thank you, Asta Sabu ma'am, for helping Anil sir with the presentation. I would like to thank I would also like to thank Vivek Bhatwadekar sir for setting the tone of today's session. Rajesh Bagwe sir for moderating the Q&A session. Appreciation to our institute, late Narayan Megaji Lokhande, Maharashtra Institute of Labor Studies, our director, Visham Deshpande sir, our faculty, Kadukar sir, and our alumni association committee members, Ahire sir and Prabhakar Patil sir and other committee members for extending their support to make this event happen. I also like to thank all the participants present here today for actively listening to today's session on emotional intelligence. And I extend my deep gratitude to Sri Prabhakar Patil sir for giving me an opportunity to propose a vote of thanks for today's session. And with the thank you note to everyone, I end up my thank you note to everyone. Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
Thank you so very much.
Yes, yes. Patil sir, it's a very good coincidence that the group of batchmates come together.
Yes.
Yeah, Prabhakar Patil sir. You along with Anil sir, Vivek Bhatwadekar sir, and Rajesh Bagwe sir.
Rajesh Bagwe. Yes.
Yeah. So it's a
job.
Absolutely.
They have reached to such a level of a career.
Yeah.
At least they have a very good experience, excellent experience as far as this management part is concerned, emotional intelligence concerned. So, but at least here they will share their experience with the both student as well as the alumni. thanks, Anil. Thank you very much for that. Yeah.
Thank you so
much. Thanks very much.
Yeah.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.